right. Well, it looks like we're pretty darn close to the top of the hour. So let me go ahead and start up my screen share. Ooh, it's gonna apparently I'm gonna break someone else's screen share. Maybe I'll give that a minute. Or maybe I'll just take it. We'll just take it. All right. Let's do that screen. That sounds like fun. Get that out of the way. Don't need to see that guy. All right. So good evening, good afternoon. My name is Nate Shuda. Thank you for hanging out with me. I wish we were in person. I think we're going to get back to that soon for some value of soon. I guess we'll see. Just as an aside, I do also perform this particular material or deliver this material, I guess, better way of saying that, in a much longer format, 4 hours or more, actually, with my colleague here, Jakob. And so we do that on O'Reilly's platform and other places as well. So if you're interested in this and you want to see more, feel free to ping us. I'm sure we're doing this somewhere sometime over the next few months. If you're interested in architecture, which I'm guessing you are, if you're going to talk with me, I did do this report a couple of years ago, kind of on my thoughts around what it means to think architecturally, things of that nature. My wife lovingly, I think, refers to this as a pamphlet because, it's like 70 pages or 60 pages. I can't even remember, but you can snag this from us if you're interested. And I'll be talking more about this tomorrow, but I can't really swing a dry erase marker without somebody asking me about microservices these days. So I do obviously have thoughts on that. And again, I'm pretty sure I'm delving more deeply into that tomorrow. All right. Now, I've been in software a long time, and it used to be a little simpler than it is today. We had a monolith or two, and we released versions occasionally a few times a year, and everybody worked on the same floor or at least within walking distance of one another. But that's just not where we live today. And there's a pretty good chance that you have dozens, hundreds, maybe thousands of services. You might not even know how many services you have in your organization because they come and go with such regularity. And every time you turn around, someone's putting a new version out there. And of course, we're not all in one place anymore. In fact, I think the vast majority of my career has involved continent teams, quite frankly, not even just regions. And so now we've got team members all around the globe. And I can assure you, at least from my seat, architecting has never been an easy job. And then you now give me the responsibility for these massively distributed applications whose teams are geographically dispersed. And it's like, whoa, what did I sign up for here? This really wasn't my intent. The reality is we are spread really thin. I used to think that my organization had not such great architects. And then I became one. And like the next day, 35 projects were dropped on my head, none of which I had any background in. It was just told, here, go solve problems. It's like, oh, okay, cool. And what you realize very quickly as an architect is you can't, in fact, be everywhere at all times. You can't, in fact, be involved with every decision. We shouldn't be involved with every decision. We need to empower our teams to make good decisions without us in the room. And so we have to get comfortable with this distributed decision-making concept. Now, that doesn't mean we just sort of, throw up our hands and say, hey, your problem, not mine. It's on us to establish good principles so that our teams are making good decisions when we're not in the room. It is in some ways like parenting. I cannot prepare my teenager for every situation he's going to encounter in life, but hopefully I've given him the right background and principles that he can make good decisions when he encounters these, various things he's going to run into as he grows into a young adult. Of course, I think one of the scary things about parenting, and software is not a heck of a lot different from this, you don't know if you've been successful in many cases until, well, it's too late to do anything about it. Oops. The other thing we can do as architects is leverage the power of defaults. Now, to give you some background on this idea, actually comes out of economics and this idea of sort of behavioral economics. Not a new idea. This has been around now for a couple of decades, and it sort of challenges the idea of us being like rational actors when it comes to how we invest for the future. And it's an incredibly powerful set of information, powerful enough that one of its founders won a Nobel Prize for it. And I know you might be thinking, geez, Nate, I'm not an economics talk. I'm talking about architecture here, how I don't see the connection. This quote from Thaler really kind of brings it home for me, which is if you want to get somebody to do something, you need to make it easy. It needs to be just like falling out of bed easy. And so that's what we need to do. You know, if you're trying to, you know, pick up a new habit, trying to work out more, exercise more, you know, one of the things people will say is, you know, make sure your exercise clothing is ready to go, that it's, you know, it's by the door, so you don't have to hunt for it. You know, I do this with my son before, you know, practice. I make sure, hey, you got everything you need, right? You've packed your bag the night before, so we're not scrambling in the morning as we're heading out the door. As architects, we can do the same thing. We need to use that to our advantage. And again, I know some of you might be thinking, hang on, Nate, how does this have anything to do with us? Well, as architects, we need to wield the power of defaults as well. And so for us, what this means is I want to make the right choice, the easy choice. And so when you deal with these distributed systems, you discover very quickly that they all need similar things. We need to have monitoring in place to have any idea what's going on in these systems. They're very complicated, a lot of spinning plates. I can't just put a breakpoint in and walk through the code anymore. You know, so I need more information on what's actually happening under the covers. I've got to have circuit breakers in place so that if something goes wrong, I don't burn down the proverbial house. I probably want some consumer-driven contracts so that as I evolve these services, I can do that confidently knowing I'm not breaking somebody that's relying on what my service provides. Might need some gateways, some streams, got to externalize configuration. You know, maybe we're going to do some functions and just where are all my services? Where do they live? Well, we need service discovery. We need a load balance across instances. Need to make sure I've got some documentation in place. The challenge for us as architects is we cannot afford to reinvent the wheel on every project. I actually got together last night with a good friend of mine, a gentleman I've known for a couple of decades, software guy, just like me. And this is one of the things we talked about, actually, was how many times in our career we've seen teams reinvent the wheel, invent, you know, basically create their own version of something that already existed. And in fact, this came up yesterday in my presentation. Somebody asked me about that around CI/CD. Yeah, we really shouldn't be building our own. We should be leveraging existing tools. And if we do try to reinvent these things in every project, we end up with something that makes suburban sprawl look attractive. What I love about Spring is that it frees us to focus on these critical design decisions that matter. You know, let's make sure we're seeing the forest here. We understand the key business drivers for this application, but it doesn't tie our developers' hands either. And it gives them the ability to solve these critical business problems with plenty of opportunities to make changes that are logical for this application. This is the right choice for this application. Now, having done this for a while, I can assure you there's a lot of ways, excuse me, to fail with a distributed application. Spring is here to help. It's here to help you. It's here to help your teams. It's here to help your applications. And it'll also help all of us get a good night's sleep, which is, you know, something that we should all strive for. At the end of the day, this is all about delivering business value to production. And that's really what we're talking about here. So let me do a little bit of level setting here so we're all on the same page. You know, what do we even mean by cloud native? What does this have to do with Spring? And so always ask your doctor if cloud native is right for you. Sometimes we lose sight of this a little bit, but at the end of the day, it's just an application that was designed to take advantage of what cloud computing gives us. So how do we create and deploy applications? Now, as I've already insinuated, cloud computing gives us some really interesting capabilities. You know, I can scale up, I can scale down, I can do that all on demand. I have a limitless compute with that really big asterisk that, you know, we're just going to charge you more for that. And of course, if you've done any cloud computing, you realize that some of these fees are a little opaque. And I know I talked a little bit about some of this yesterday, but it's very easy to turn on a whole bunch of things and not realize you turn them on. And all of a sudden you're still getting billed for it. And you're like, oops, you know, and sometimes these cost calculators can be a little complicated. There's a lot of things you can turn on. Now, I would argue that this is just the democratization of technology. That at the end of the day, this has always been there. It's just now we as architects, we as developers have to understand this more than we did in the past. We can't just sort of offload this to our production support people. We now have the ability to go click, 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 and oh, look what I did. And then, you know, some operator slapping their forehead going, boy, you did that in a really cost ineffective way. There's better ways of doing it. It's also important for us maybe to turn some things off that we're not using. This is actually a conversation my wife and I've had about, do we really need all of these streaming services? Can we go through and trim some of these things? And so I realize I'm in for this at some point, a bit of a reckoning on my own subscription bills. Now, cloud native is more than just an architectural pattern. It's this interesting combination of, you know, practices and techniques and technologies. You know, there's going to be some agile development in there and some continuous delivery, which I talked about yesterday, and some automation, which I talked about yesterday. And you're probably going to have some containerization and maybe some microservices and some functions. But one of the pieces that we neglect here is culture. And it's important that we understand that this will affect our culture as well. And, you know, technology changes are something that we're all pretty comfortable with. I mean, I am. I like changing technologies, but you have to understand the cultural impact of that. And if you don't evolve the culture along with the technology, you're going to be in for some pain. That does mean some amount of DevOps as well. And it's just an acknowledgement of the big shift we've seen in infrastructure. You know, it's very different than when I first got into industry. And, you know, when I go back to the early days of my own experience, our servers were these homegrown, you know, bespoke artisanal things. And as much as I love bespoke coffee, that's not great for my infrastructure. I need more consistency there. Thank you. And, you know, we'd spend days handcrafting these things. And so we treated them like pets. You know, these are my pets. This is Han in the front, Chewie in the back. They're floating around somewhere here in my house. You know, they actually do kind of like to hang out in my meetings, and they like to participate. Han in particular likes to pair present with me, likes to lay on my lap and touch the keyboard at inopportune moments. Now, these two little furry critters are basically members of my family. And if either one of them were to get a sniffle, we'd spend a considerable amount of money making them happy and healthy again. And that's kind of how we used to treat our servers. You know, we would do pretty much anything we could to keep them happy, keep them healthy. And we gave them pithy names. I worked at one company where all our servers were named after Simpsons characters. And a friend of mine said all theirs were named after Marvel characters, you know, and they used to get a kick out of saying, "Hey, Spidey fell over again." Now, at this era, servers were this really heavily constrained resource, and they were really, really expensive. You know, there were billion-dollar corporations that existed just to sell us this proprietary stuff. And so we start doing these web apps, and our accountants are like, whoa, you can't just put one app on there. That ain't going to work. And so thus was born the app server. And so now it became in our best interest to put as many apps as possible on that server so that the accountants would leave us alone because, hey, look, you just maximized ROI. That makes them happy. Now, the downside of this is, of course, unintended side effects. Because now that I have shared resources, it's very easy for one application's bug to take down multiple applications. You know, this happened to me on some random Monday morning. I came in, one of my applications was down, start digging into it and realize that, over the weekend, someone had put in a MIME type change. 9 out of the 10 apps on that server went down. The only one that was still up was the one that wanted the MIME type change. Now, I don't understand or know why a MIME type change caused us to go down. I don't know why it wasn't caught in a lower region. Who knows? Your guess is as good as mine, but not exactly the way I wanted to kick my week off. Coordinating changes in this era was very painful. And I cannot tell you how many conversations I had where essentially I was told you can't have nice things until everyone's ready to have that. And we have to move as slowly as our slowest moving app. And by the way, they're not going to take the new version of Java for another, 3 or 4 years. And you just start tearing out your hair and you're like, you're kidding me, right? I've got this bug that's fixed, or this is so much easier in the new version. And you're telling me I can't have that. You're killing me, Smalls. I've been on some of these currency projects, and they're these 18-month slogs of freezes and testing and frustration and, you know, just these minute little things, and people are getting their stack blown, and it's just not a lot of fun. And I do think this is why a lot of organizations said, you know what, currency's just not worth it. It's not my problem. I'm going to kick the can down the street. Let somebody else deal with this in the future, and, you know, I'll be promoted out of here by then. So, you know, or I'll leave before it becomes an issue. And it made me think of this Yoda quote, you know, fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering. And, you know, who knew so many organizations were really practicing Yoda ops and didn't even know that was a thing. Now, of course, during this era of software, it was kind of following that nuke and pave approach to deployments. You know, I would move code from one instance of an app server to another instance of an app server, overlay whatever was there before. And, you know, it's all supposed to work because the environments are the same, except, well, it worked in dev, but it didn't work in test. And they were all just staring at each other like, why not? I mean, my infrastructure folks assured me they're the same. The most egregious example I ran into worked in one region, not the other. We spent about 2 weeks digging into this. And what we discovered at the end of this slog was, oh yeah, the patches were applied in a different order. That's why, you know, this server worked and that one didn't. And, you know, this is when after beating your head against the wall and you get so much of a headache, you're like, can I change careers? Like, you know, what life choices brought me to this point? Now, luckily for my forehead, things have started to change. And we've reached this stage now where, to be honest, servers are just kind of a commodity item. And, you know, we use Linux and Intel chips to replace the custom operating systems, that specialized chipsets we had in the past. And, you know, I think if you would have told a, you know, an 18-year-old me that the dominant computing platform of 2020s and beyond was going to be, you know, a version of Unix, I would have laughed at you. Like, you're kidding me, right? Which leads me to another one of my all-time favorite tweets. What are clouds made of? Well, Linux servers mostly. Absolutely true. Prices have since dropped, and we realize servers actually aren't the constraining factor. It's us. It's the people costs. And so as things like Heroku and the various cloud providers have shown up, and things like Cloud Foundry and whatnot have kind of made their presence known, we realize that shared servers are actually a liability now. And it's in our best interest to treat them like cattle. When they get sick, let's just get a new instance of that one. You know, if you've ever seen a large scale cattle operation, they generally don't name the cows. They give the cows numbers. You know, no offense to number 15 here, but if number 15 is too sick, we're just going to get a new instance of number 15. And that's kind of what we need to do with our servers. We shouldn't be so attached to them. You know, it's that sort of Phoenix server idea. And this has given us a bunch of new abstractions. You know, we've got containers and platforms that allow us to just package the app up with everything it needs. And let's move that from one environment to another, which means that if it works in dev, well, it's going to work in test because it's the same thing. In fact, there's a pretty good chance that we didn't even move anything. We just updated a routing table. We've just removed a whole bunch of variables from the equation. That's a good thing for us. That's a big win for us. So if your app needs some spiffy new library, outstanding. You want to update to the latest version of Java? That's great. Knock yourself out. You aren't impacting anyone else. You are isolated from everyone else. This fundamentally moves the value line for us. And that's huge because at the end of the day, our customers care about us putting features and functionality into production reliably and repeatedly. That's what they want. They don't want more Kubernetes or more Docker or more Kafka. You know, I mean, we get excited about all that for good reasons, but that's not what they're asking for. They're asking us to solve their business problems. And so we want to spend as much of our time as possible on those kinds of activities and get out of this undifferentiated heavy lifting that we've done for a pretty good chunk of my career. Now, this has a pretty major change on our approach to development. It allows us to embrace that always be changing mindset, and we can run experiments and do A-B tests and be much more responsive to our business partners. And this allows us to turn things around in days, not months. And that's huge for us. You know, the pressures that we're facing mean we have to be very responsive. And so this idea of the quarterly release cycles just got to go away. We need to embrace the idea of doing thousands of deploys a month, potentially. And that takes time and that takes engineering discipline, that takes cultural change, but convenient or not, speed matters. And this disruption is impacting all of us. None of us are immune. I think that was a pretty big shot across the bow when Amazon bought Whole Foods, and all of a sudden now you can order your groceries while you're ordering, you know, your books and everything else. A lot of insurance companies have realized actually Google's kind of a competitor of ours in certain ways because it's all about information and complex models. And convenient or not, we're all technology companies today. Now, to be fair, this actually works out really well for us because, you know, it allows us to kind of emphasize the stuff that we're good at and, again, be part of that, that differentiator in a lot of organizations. Okay, so what is Spring? How is this going to help us with these cloud-native applications? Well, quite simply, if you're unfamiliar with Spring, it's an integration framework, and it combines a whole lot of different things together, giving us a very consistent programming model. It was designed back in the day to simplify Java development, although it does support other JVM languages such as Kotlin and Groovy. And it is a growing family of projects built on top of the Spring framework. Now, it gives us a whole lot of support for different types of application architectures. So whatever you're working on, there's a pretty good chance Spring has an answer for you, whether that's message-driven, reactive, you're doing microservices, you're doing a traditional web app. We give you a lot of choices. And one of the things that as an architect, I really appreciate about Spring is it gives you that flexibility of swapping things in and out when you need to. Oh, you need to switch message brokers? No problem. we can do that. You're still programming to the same approach, the same APIs. We can swap out that message broker later. Oh, change in data stores, again, no problem. Same APIs, we'll just swap it out behind the scenes, hide that boilerplate from you. It is backwards compatible. The team does yeoman's work, making sure that they're not breaking things across versions. They usually cover a bunch of different JDKs, and they work, again, very hard to make sure they're minimizing any breaking changes. I also appreciate how much thought was put into the APIs. I mean, this was really sort of like user-centered, developer-centered APIs, as opposed to whatever random names, you know, some of us have come up with in our careers. It's also very high quality code. I've been doing this series on sort of software engineering fundamentals. And one of the things I'm stressing in that is we need to read more code, which then of course leads to the natural question of, well, what code should I read? And so one of the things I point people to is the Spring code base, because it is very well-written code. You can drop in pretty much any file. You're gonna see some pretty good stuff. Very clean code and excellent documentation, something I very much appreciate. It's been around a while. You know, this is a mature framework. This was released in mid-2003. And of course, for some developers, like, oh, that's like the Paleolithic era. Why would I use something that's that old? I need to be on something that's, you know, a 0.3, because that's way cooler. It reminds me of this fantastic thread from Jeff Johnson. He talks about a lot of developers are afraid of old things because they think old is always arcane and complex, and the new is always simple and elegant. When in reality, what we usually have is the new is unfinished, buggy, and unproven, whereas the older stuff is refined and stable and tested. We don't always need to reinvent the wheel. Now, this was originally built to simplify Java EE development, or even so far back as when we put a 2 in there. And ultimately, trying to give us what EJBs promised without all the overhead of EJBs. And this is built around POJOs, plain old Java objects, as well as inversion of control, otherwise known as dependency injection. It's really a large example of what I refer to as the zeroth law of computer science. It's all about loose coupling and high cohesion. It's a declarative programming model that goes out of its way to eliminate boilerplate. I'm a big fan of eliminating boilerplate. I don't like typing extra stuff if I don't have to. Now, it has grown considerably from its initial days. That's not too surprising. And so it can be a little overwhelming when you're like, whoa, what is all this stuff? Well, we're going to try to simplify a little bit of that here today. A Spring Boot, sometimes used interchangeably with Spring, is just an opinionated view of Spring that simplifies our ability to build applications. Now, it's not an app server, despite the way some people refer to it, although it does embed a servlet container. It just doesn't implement all the Java specs. It just configures beans that do. It's also not a code generator. I'm not a huge fan of code generators because that still leaves stuff that I have to work with and remember to change. And oh, I got to blow this away and regenerate it. And that can be a very painful exercise. It does a lot of automatic configuration for us as well. Again, trying to free you from boilerplate as much as possible. If you go to Spring Initializer, which apparently is Josh's second favorite place on the internet, start.spring.io, you can go ahead and type in whatever you need, get yourself set up. You pick your language, you pick your build version or your build preferences, whatever boot version you want, set some metadata, what kind of packaging do you want to use? What Java level are you going to use? And then you just pick whatever dependencies your project needs. So pretty much anything you can think of is in there. You go ahead and just go tap, tap, tap. And now you've got, at the end of the day, a starter project that you can use to get things rolling. Now, if you don't like the GUIs, that's cool. There is a command line version as well. And regardless of how you get the starter, you open it up in your favorite IDE and away you go. A lot of IDEs actually have some of that built into it today. And we do have some clients who've taken Spring Initializer and customized it so that their developers don't have to wade through and go, I want this, this, and this. They have certain defaults that they've chosen for their organization. This is our standard Java level. We want to use Maven or we want to use Gradle. You know, and oh, you're doing a web project, we're going to pre-configure with this. Oh, you're doing an event-driven architecture, we're going to pre-configure you with this. You know, so again, trying to reduce some of that decision-making that developers have to deal with. Now, Spring Cloud is another aspect of this ecosystem. And what Spring Cloud is trying to get to is what I mentioned at the beginning of the day here, which is distributed applications have a lot of similar needs. again, don't reinvent the wheel every time. We've already got good solutions to some of these. And so Spring Cloud is this massive umbrella project with out-of-the-box solutions to a number of the things that we normally encounter on these kinds of projects. So you pretty much name it, it's in here in some way, shape, or form. Some of it specific to a cloud provider, some of it more general in nature. And again, gives us these defaults that are useful for us for cloud native applications. We're not trying to dictate what provider you use. And again, you can use start.spring.io to get going, but it's there to help you with the externalized configuration. It does integrate with a number of things that the Netflix folks have contributed. There's security, distributed tracing, support for event-driven applications, support for building pipelines, service discovery, connectors, I mean, and on. We'll go more into that in a minute. There's also Spring Data, and we could easily do an hour on that. This is a Spring way of accessing your data models. You know, this is a massive project as well. And so this is how you would access your data store of choice. Doesn't matter what kind of data store we're talking about, relational, non-relational, one of the cloud ones, MapReduce, it's cool. We can support it in some way, shape, or form. And again, I could go on and on and on and on. And there are full talks just on the topic of what is Spring. In fact, at last year's Spring One, I believe the most viewed talk was what is Spring, which was a little bit of a surprise to me, although I think it's a good reminder that there's a lot of folks who, you know, are new to this topic. And so that's part of was my inspiration actually for pulling this talk together. I actually have this book sitting next to me. Greg Walz's book is kind of the book on Spring. Big fan of his writing. I'm actually working through one of his tech editing, one of his books right now on a different subject, but Craig really is an excellent writer. And as far as I'm concerned, probably the best way to get your head wrapped around Spring if you like to read. If you prefer more video type content, a friend of mine, Ken Cousins, put together this whole Spring Boot learning path on O'Reilly. We've written extensively about this on our developer portal as well. So a lot of information out there on Spring and the various components. All right, so let's jump into some of the pieces of Spring Cloud and see what kind of trouble that gets us into. And so I always like to start with monitoring, because you can't have a distributed architecture without good monitoring in place. Now, there's four primary components to monitoring if we look at this with our SRE hat on. And, you know, first step is logging, which is just another way of saying, you know, what would you say your service is doing? Now, we obviously want to log anything that's useful so long as it's not personally identifiable information. You know, don't ever put PII stuff in your logs. One of the things that can be a little challenging for us is realizing that, you know, some things aren't PII by themselves, but when I combine it with these other three things, now all of a sudden I know exactly who you are. Tracing can be difficult in these applications. You know, they're highly distributed. You may not have access to all the code. So I can't just put a breakpoint in and, you know, step my way through the transaction, because this is now bouncing between 5 or 10 or 20 different services. So I need to have some correlation IDs to figure out who's talking to who. Now, as you can guess, we've got an answer to that. So that's Spring Cloud Sleuth. So this is auto configuration for distributed tracing. Covers all the topics you'd expect, spans, sampling, key value pairs, et cetera. It'll add the trace and span IDs on the stock ingress and egress points for you. And so it'll instrument those common ingress and egress points as well. If you are in the Zipkin ecosystem, you can get Zipkin compatible traces out of that. And all you have to do, and this is pretty much the standard for everything here, is you just add Sleuth to your class path. And then now your boot app can generate all that trace data for you. We also need some dashboards, which is just a way of giving me a view into the health of this service. So we want our metrics to be displayed on some sort of a dashboard. Of course, we still need to be alerted when things go a little wonky. Ironically enough, my car this morning when I went to take my son to school said, hey, I need maintenance B1, whatever the heck that is. So I guess I'm gonna have to deal with that sometime in the next week or so. There's also alerting. Now, this is a key metric is out of band in some way, shape, or form. And so that's what allows us to detect an issue and ideally fix it before our customers even realize that something is amiss. That does imply pager duty, which needs to be sustainable, by the way. You should have good, clear, concise on-call documentation for your staff. And do not be clever. Do not assume everyone understands every little nuance. Don't just write, you know, clear the cache. Tell me how to do that. Because even if I know or should know in a pressure packed situation or just a sleep deprived situation, I may not be thinking my best or clearest. So please give me really step-by-step instructions on how to do this. And don't skip a step, because everybody knows to do this, right? Reminds me of this fantastic quote: we don't rise to the level of our expectations, we fall to the level of our training. So we have to think about what we need to monitor. We have to think about what a key metric might be. And some of those just matter about the infrastructure, you know, CPU utilization, RAM utilization, connections to the database. And it isn't just going to affect us. It's going to affect other services as well. But there's also things that just affect our service. And so maybe that's latency and response time and availability, et cetera. It's pretty much anything we may have identified early on in the process as a service level objective for us. We need to make sure we're monitoring errors and exceptions, and we need to think in terms of a normal sort of situation is between this range. And if we start to see this, well, that's a warning. Oh, if we get to here, you know, well, that's going to be a problem. Now, this is hard sometimes to know a priori, like what should we do? And you might need some history before you can get comfortable with this. And also something we should be doing outside of prod too. We should have good monitoring in our staging and our lower environments so that, well, we can validate that the monitors are giving us everything we need. So we need those metrics on a dashboard of some sort. And then again, we need to be alerted when things start to go out of band, because I don't want developers staring at dashboards all day. You know, that's not productive, and we're not good at that either, by the way. You know, if you've ever seen the person manning the X-ray machine at an airport, I can't imagine a more boring job as things worldwide, because 99.9 times out of 100, there's nothing in the bag. And you've got to look for the one needle in a haystack after seeing no needles for, you know, hours. That's why they usually rotate those people in and out pretty quickly. So we want to alert on all of our key metrics, SLOs, et cetera. Understand that absence of a metric is probably an alertable offense as well. And the key thing with alerts is they need to be actionable, and there needs to be a sense of urgency here. And they also need to require some kind of a human to intervene. If the system can fix itself, that's not an alert. That's something that maybe goes on a report or goes to a monitor, a dashboard somewhere, you know, so people can see, oh, maybe we got a problem here. If the system fixed it, though, I don't need an alert telling me that the system fixed this problem I didn't even know we had. If you have not familiarized yourself with the site reliability engineering and you are doing these kinds of applications, I strongly recommend you go to the web and poke around in this a little bit. You don't have to read it cover to cover, but a lot of good information in here, especially around the four golden signals. This is one of my favorite aspects of it. And so they talk about latency. You know, how long does it take to service a request? What's my traffic level? What's the level of demand on my system? How many requests per second am I getting, et cetera? What's my error rate? Now, this could be an explicit error, an implicit error, et cetera. And saturation, how much of a constrained resource do I have left? We do need to think about sampling frequency. As much as we want even higher resolution, it doesn't always matter. You know, the jump from sort of standard definition television to high definition television was pretty massive. And I guess I'm not so sure how many more K we need before eyes are like, I really can't tell the difference here. Although interestingly enough, it's amazing how realistic some of these things have gotten. My son was playing FIFA on the PlayStation the other day, and my wife actually thought it was a real game. And so she was asking, hey, who's Man City playing? And my son had to say, well, I'm playing FIFA. And she did a double take to realize, oh, that's not actually, you know, watching this from, you know, England. We do need to aggregate this data up, and there's a ton of different tools here that you can use. And of course, I can get a lot of information right out of Spring Boot thanks to Actuator. And so we poke around Actuator and we see right away there's a lot here, and I can leverage a lot of existing monitoring systems as well. We can't afford for monitoring to be hand-rolled. We don't want metrics to be a hand-rolled thing. I mean, I'm not a big fan of hand-roll anything on software. So take advantage of the built-in endpoints. And there's an awful lot there that is very logical and will give you a lot of good information. If there's other things you need, cool. You can create custom endpoints to your heart's content. It takes time to get this right. Don't expect to get there on the first day or the first application. Share those lessons learned, tweak, adapt, try again, tweak, adapt, try again, and you'll zero in on what makes sense for your applications. this again is a lot of why I think we're hearing about SRE and site reliability engineering, and it's becoming a bigger topic, largely because we're realizing that to run these apps at scale, these heavily distributed systems, we just need a little more discipline there, a little more rigor around how we've been doing it. Be careful with metrics that are easy to measure. Just because it's easy to measure doesn't mean it matters. Sorry about that. And we also need to understand key business drivers. You know, this is where we have to talk to our business analysts, our product owners, our customers, and just say, hey, you know, help me understand what would cause a big spike in demand for us. You know, is it just we've got a big sales sort of push coming up, and so we're going to try to drive a bunch of customers to the new sign up. You know, what is it that's going to see a big spike, and what does that spike look like? You know, we need to be realistic here. Not every application is going to be a third of internet traffic. You know, and so we need to understand, like, what does that mean for us? Thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, what kind of response time is reasonable? You know, what do our competitors provide? And then we need to figure out how to translate that to the services that we're actually writing. Again, be realistic. I've seen too many people be like, oh my God, we're a rocket ship heading to the moon and we're going to have 19 billion customers. And it's like, how's that possible? There aren't even that many humans. So are cats and dogs going to be using our system? I mean, that'd be kind of cool, but that sounds like it has some really interesting other issues we'd probably have to deal with. Now, a lot of information out there on this. Imagine that if you want to go deeper, there's various resources, and I've tried to put links, I think, to everything that I've talked about here. So we've got videos, a lot of videos. Josh puts out spring tips on a very regular basis. In fact, Josh doesn't know how to go on vacation. He was on vacation this summer and kept posting while on vacation. It's like, Josh, I don't think that word means what you think it means, buddy. And so he's got a tip up there on Wavefront. And unsurprisingly, we have another video that goes deeper into observability. Next thing I think about as an architect is fault tolerance. Yeah, so when you start building these distributed applications, you realize that they're not islands unto themselves. You know, it's this giant collection of spinning plates, and services fail. And to sort of paraphrase my favorite fictional chaos mathematician, failures find a way. Now, our customers don't care why the application's down. They're just yelling at us to make sure the application comes back up. You know, I can only imagine what it must have been like to be in sort of infrastructure engineering at Facebook earlier this week when they decided to update the BGP records and blew away their network. You know, I'm sure that was a good time. The reality, and this is something that is not always comfortable for us to admit, but we can't prevent every failure. We just can't. But we can be prepared for it. That's what we have to embrace. And so we know a service is going to fall over. We know we're going to get a bad response. We know something crazy is going to happen. It's on us to make sure our system reacts appropriately when these things happen. Now, what's an appropriate reaction? Is it an error message? Do we call a backup service? Do we just have some cache data somewhere? Do we just return 42 every time? Now, I've discovered in my time in software, there's three answers to every question you've ever been given, and it will work perfectly fine. I already used one of them, you know, 42. That's to see who's well-read. As an architect, I'm a big fan of another layer of indirection. But the answer I give more often than not is it depends. I mean, that's like the architect's mantra right there, to the point of my friend Mark actually has a t-shirt that says it depends on it. And he often wears that while he's giving architectural sort of, you know, presentations. And I really do need to get one of those. I told my grad students at the beginning of the semester, I said, just so you know, the answer that I'm looking for most of the time is it depends. And they picked up on that quickly. So now I get it depends echoed back to me quite often. Now, this takes us to the circuit breaker pattern. And this was identified by Michael Nygaard in ShipIt, which is somewhere over my shoulder, as I recall. And it works the exact same way as a circuit breaker does in your house. In fact, ironically enough, last night, I don't know why, but the circuit breaker tripped in our house and knocked out some of our stuff. And we're like, whoa, what just happened? And I don't know, but it was designed to prevent something worse from happening. So thank you, electricians. And so it works the same for us with software. Everything's good, no problem. Circuit's closed, things are going as normal. Uh-oh, there's an issue. We'll open it, trip the breaker, and now we're not going to keep calling something that we know is broken. And so the circuit breaker watches these calls, And then once it has exceeded some failure threshold, which obviously we can configure, circuit is opened, and then we redirect to some fallback mechanism. Now, the circuit breaker is periodically checking to say, hey, are you feeling better now? You know, how about now? Everything good? If so, cool, we close the circuit, go back to normal. Now, there's a lot of different implementations that you can choose here, and Spring Cloud Circuit Breaker steps in to say, you know what, you know you need circuit breakers. We'll give you a consistent programming model, and then you can go ahead and pick the implementation that makes the most sense for you. So consistent API, developers can change implementation if they need to. So if they want to use Hystrix, great. They want to use Sentinel, awesome. They want to use Retry, cool. Resilience for J, knock yourself out. All the same, add the proper starter to the class path, call the factory, and now you can inject that circuit breaker basically wherever you want inside your code. You can configure each circuit breaker individually if you want. You can also create sort of a default configuration that's used by all the circuit breakers, and you can pretty much change everything you can imagine, you know, failure thresholds, slow call thresholds, what's the minimum number of calls, what's that sliding window size, et cetera. You've got to have circuit breakers in place to have a healthy microservices biome, right? It isn't hard to add. It's necessary. Your customers will thank you, and it will help you avoid those 3 a.m. pages so you can get a better night's sleep, all right? So lots of information on circuit breaker out there. Unsurprisingly, there's a guide if you want to walk through how would I add this. Josh has done a Spring Tips on this as well. Now, speaking of Hystrix, that's where we kind of get into this whole SC Netflix, Spring Cloud, Netflix. And again, it should be obvious that there are distributed systems all have similar needs, right? And there's these common patterns that show up again and again, service discovery, circuit breaker, routing, et cetera. And guess who's done a lot of this? Well, we know the Netflix folks have. You know, so they've built a bunch of open source components on top of that, and we can go ahead and use that to our advantage. So we add a few annotations and we're good to go. So we can integrate this in very easily, things like Eureka. So if you want to do service discovery, that's something we kind of need in a distributed application, because it turns out things are going to move from time to time. They go up, they go down, new versions get scaled up, scaled down. You don't want to be doing that by hand. So there's Eureka server, Eureka client. It is possible to configure that HA, and it is default to run in multiple instances and then peer them together. It can also be run standalone as well. Clients register with Eureka, and you give it the common info, right? Port, host, health check, et cetera. And then you can put your Eureka client starter on the class path, and now you're auto-registered. Eureka does give a regular heartbeat from service instances, and then if it fails, it says, hey, take me out of the registry. It does use the default info and health actuator endpoints that we talked about earlier. And of course, this can all be done securely as well. Now, it can take up to 3 heartbeats for everyone to be on the same page, but you are free to shorten that if necessary. Eureka client goes ahead and actually finds those service instances. There are alternatives if you want. And yes, this does work in multiple zones. You can also say, hey, make sure you go to a service that's in the same zone as I am. Now, obviously, that's not the only thing we need. There's client-side load balancing, which you can use with or without Eureka. And again, you just add the starter and away you go. This allows you to externalize those properties via the Spring Boot configuration files. You can create defaults if you want. And you can also customize that by putting properties into the environment. You can directly access Ribbon. You can do lazy load. You can eager load. You know, again, there's a lot of information out there on registration, discovery, load balancing, et cetera. Now, fair point. Hey, aren't some of these things, you know, kind of being in maintenance mode? I'm not actively being updated. That's true. And my good friends, Marcin and Olga, have actually done a piece on, hey, what do we do to live in sort of this post-Spring cloud Netflix world? All right. So let me hop ahead very quickly here, since I know we need to leave some time for questions. So let me skip down to my wrap it up here. Okay, that's Spring React. Where it is? I need a larger monitor. All right. It isn't easy to architect these cloud native applications. There's a lot of moving parts, and distributed architectures require a lot of plumbing. Spring can help you with that. You know, I didn't get over really more than a very scratching of the surface of a few of these things. At the end of the day, we need to make the right choice, the easy choice. Now, how do you keep up with everything that's happening in Spring? It depends on your learning style. You like videos? We got a ton of videos. We got playlists upon playlists upon playlists. We've done a bunch of Spring Live type events. We did a 24 hours of Spring last year. We do Spring One Tour virtually over the last few months here. If you would like to comment along the live streams, pretty much any day of the week, we're doing a live stream. So just pick a day. On most Mondays, I'm interviewing somebody from the industry, kind of doing a, you know, inside the actor studio, if I can be so bold. On Tuesdays, we do Tanzu Tuesdays, which is usually someone demoing something, walking through some code. We have code, which, wait for it, is us coding. We also have TGIK. We've got Tanzu Talk. There's another one that's like cloud streaming. I mean, it's just, you name it, we're talking about it. And a lot of it's on Twitch. We do the Spring One Tour, which has been virtual for the last 18 months. I actually was talking with my manager yesterday. I do believe we are going to get back to in-person events sometime in 22. You like our live online stuff? Yeah, we got you covered. There's a ton of things on O'Reilly. If you're on Twitter, yeah, guess what? We're all on Twitter. You know, I obviously don't have every single member of the Spring community, but there's a bunch. And many of them, by the way, are very interactive. And if you ask them a question, they will probably answer it. You know, so don't be afraid to follow some folks and throw questions at us and see what happens. And there's a lot of really, really smart people, really kind people as well. It's part of what I love about this community is they're very good at answering questions. Now, you know, there's a lot of good folks out there. I know I've probably missed a few. And for that, I do heartfelt apologize. You know, I think this is more or less everybody that I'm following, but I'm, again, sure I missed somebody somewhere because it's really hard to kind of keep track of just how big the community is. It's actually kind of fun to go to one of our web pages. I don't remember exactly where it is, but you can actually see where all of the Spring folks live. So follow us. If you prefer to read, great. We got books upon books upon books. Craig's new version should be coming out or has come out shortly. I can't keep track anymore. Josh did React to Spring recently. Mark's Spring Boot book came out. In fact, it's over my shoulder, I believe. That came out not that long ago. If you're not sure where to start, no problem. Hang out on our site. We got a ton of information on getting started with various types of things that you might be doing, different projects, et cetera. You want some in-depth documentation? Cool. We got you covered there. Pretty much anything and everything is there. Oh, you want to do some coding? Again, we got a bunch of guides. This is how I've actually kind of gotten familiar with a lot of things in the Spring ecosystem. If you'd like to listen while you're, you know, I don't know, walking the dog or something, we got podcasts upon podcasts. Actually, my show makes for a pretty good podcast that'll be coming eventually. It's a rich ecosystem. It's a large, thriving community. There's a ton of resources out there. Ask us questions. You know, follow us, poke us, you know, ping us. We'll do our best to answer. I wish you good luck. All right, with that, I will go ahead and stop my share and see if there are any questions I can help you with here today. Let me bring the chat over here. Make sure I'm posting to everyone. All right, any questions, comments, theories, queries, anything I can do to help you here today? And I do realize that was like the, you know, threw a whole bunch of stuff at you, rapid fire, and I apologize. Awesome. Thank you. Glad you enjoyed it. Again, we've done this as a longer version as well with my friend and colleague, Jakob, where after I rattle on for a while, Jakob live codes, you know, it's a nice counterbalance to me just shouting at people. So... awesome. I appreciate that, friends. Cool, cool. All right. Well, if there aren't any questions, here we go. Any advice on how to get started, get some direct mentoring? So it kind of depends a little bit on what you want to learn more about. Again, almost all of the leads and sort of committer type folks are on Twitter. They're very active on Twitter. And many of them, if you ping them a direct question, they will answer it and they will help you. I will say one of the things that I really do appreciate about this community is they're very welcoming to new folks. You know, this isn't a we're going to haze you for 18 months before you're worthy. There is no such thing as a dumb question. You know, I've asked some pretty basic questions and the Spring folks are excellent at answering and answering with kindness. So don't be afraid to do that. I actually had Olga on BCAC, couple of weeks ago, and that was one of the things she and I talked about. Is like, how do you get started in kind of the spring? You know, if you wanted to be a committer, we actually do have a bunch of bugs that are marked as, you know, like first time bugs, and people will basically pair with you to get comfortable committing to that. So again, if there's something specific, a specific project, don't be afraid to reach out to the people that work on it and say, hey, could you give me some help? And we could definitely do that. So I believe I've published this deck, and if not, I can certainly send it to the organizers and then they can spin it out. But yeah, I suppose I could tweet that out too. That would be another option. But because there's an awful lot of them out there. Again, if you look at the documentation, you can usually figure out sort of who is the committers. By obviously, if you go to the code directly, you can see it there. And then it's pretty straightforward to find us on Twitter in various ways, shapes, and forms. So awesome. Thank you. Any other questions, comments, anything else I can help anybody with today? I do appreciate your time. If you think of something later, feel free to ping me on Twitter. I'm happy to at least try to direct you in the right spot and, you know, take a shot in answering anyway. All right. Well, thank you all, and have a great day, and we'll see you again tomorrow. Cheers.